It is now 6:01. The time is here, and that's exciting. So I'm Beth, and you probably know that. I'm best known in the comedy world for creating, hosting, producing UnCabaret. UnCabaret was the first alternative comedy show and is very known for working with people who have a very specific voice, who all sound like themselves, who no one sounds like each other. It's based in storytelling. And I've worked with, I mean, the group has been incredible. Bob Odenkirk, Patton Oswalt. I have my mug here. I have my UnCabaret 25th anniversary mug. Dana Gould, Michael Patrick King, Margaret Cho, Taylor Negron, Tim Bagley, Sandra Bernhard, Rory Scoville, Alec Mappa, Mike McDonald, Blaine Capatch, Sherry O'Terry, Bob Odenkirk, Jeff Garland, Mary Lynn Ricecup, Dan Harmon in the day, David Cross, Paul F. Tompkins, Terry Sweeney, Greg Berendt, Lori Kilmartin, Kathy Griffin, Julia Sweeney, Jen Kirkman, Sarah Silverman. I mean, just it does literally go on and on. Janine Garofalo, Bobcat Goldthwait, Julie Goldman, Wayne Fetterman, Lauren Weedman, and Tig Notaro. So it's a good group, and it's a good mug to drink out of and remind myself of those nights when I'm slogging through the work. If you have questions, you'll chat them in, and let's get going with some more information. I'm going to share with you some small tips, some little techniques, and then some bigger ideas. And they're going to be mixed up. The biggest idea is that You But Funnier is about really being you and knowing yourself. I mean, that's not necessarily something that I can help you do in this webinar, but I can help you understand that is the most important thing. I have a couple of techniques that I've developed that can help you do that. Obviously, any kind of therapy or introspection or writing is going to help you get there. But one of the reasons for this is in live comedy, especially if you are on stage and you don't fully know yourself, an audience will often be worried about you. And one of the things that keeps people from laughing is worry about you. I think it's because people are nice. There may be some other reason. I think it's because people are like, oh my God, is she okay? So there are sometimes you'll see somebody and it's like almost funny. It's very close to being funny. I call that being comedy adjacent. Why isn't she funny? Why isn't it actually happening? And it's because often two things. One, you've assumed that the audience knows something that they don't know. And that can often happen if you're going to do, sometimes you end up doing your setup as an explanation. You've written something funny and then you explain it. The explanation is really the setup and you haven't done the rewriting. So that can happen. That's a writing problem. The bigger problem is if you don't actually know yourself, then what happens is that the audience is sitting there going like, but doesn't she know she's crazy? Doesn't she know that, you know, her mother, doesn't she know she, you know, that's why a lot of times people will say, I know what you're thinking. I know what you're thinking, I think is like the sort of the cheap version of that, because number one, you don't know. It's a little pet peeve I have. Anytime a comedian says, I know what you're thinking, I'm like, you don't. You actually don't know what I'm thinking. And they like, it's a really, I mean, lose me. But one thing is, you can really talk about anything. I like to use, like, Julia Sweeney as a great example. The show that she did, God Said Ha, where she talked about her cancer, her brother's cancer, and how that story unfolded. You would think, oh my God, how's she gonna be able to do that? That seems really hard, but she was so okay with it. She was so, knew what was happening and wasn't worried about it. And whereas our friend Judy Toll at the same time was diagnosed with cancer and she was worried about it and she was a hypochondriac and she never got on stage again. So it's not because she was worried about herself. And so she was worried and the audience was worried. And one thing that happens is, I mean, especially now, I mean, we're talking about comedy now, you know, in this crazy time. Now is one of the things that makes comedy great. one of the things that you love about comedy is that you're listening to people in the now talk about this now. So whether it's the now of a comedy club, which is one of the greatest experiences, you're in a room and somebody on stage like names the moment and it's like, oh my God, they named it. It's so great. But the now can also be this week. It could be this month. It could be this year. It could be the millennium. I mean, as long as you're plugged into it as a very now experience, that's very dynamic. And that dynamism is going to carry a lot. But what happens is if, you know, you have questions about the now. So people come in, audience comes in, whether it's to a Zoom room, whether it's to a club, a theater, whether it's to your novel that's supposed to be funny, to a podcast. Everyone's so exhausted. I mean, aren't you tired? I'm scrolling through. You guys look tired. some of you do. And we are. I mean, it takes a lot. It's a big adventure right now. It's a big experiment. And we're all experimenting all the time now, trying to make a new world to, you know, what have been our assumptions? How can we understand things differently? How can we navigate this completely new terrain, which includes, you know, mortal fear and includes having to reinvent ourselves for work and includes re-relationshiping in ways that we're co-house bound. I mean, the uncertainty, you know, not to mention the political situation. So, you know, all of this, every single person in the audience, in your audience, is coming to you with that, with all of that. And now they want you to do your work. And your work is knowing yourself. If you don't know yourself and you don't work from a place of, I know who I am, you know, so if you don't know who you are, they've got to do the work for you. And they don't have the energy. They don't have the energy to write your setup. They don't have the energy to figure out who you are. They don't have the energy to, you know, go, am I supposed to know their pronoun? Am I supposed to not know their pronoun? You know, so this is why a lot of times people will do something like, you know, really related to looks, or if somebody's, you see people a lot of times saying, you know, I know I'm fat and the fat jokes, or I know I'm this way and this, you know, these jokes. The thing that drives me crazy about that is not actually the material, but the one dimensionality of it. I love comedy that's three-dimensional, that gives you a three-dimensional person. And that's the richest comedy. If you look at the comedians that you've loved over your life, you will find almost every single one of them had a three-dimensional understanding, at least three dimensions of themselves. So one of the techniques that I teach, and which I'll share with you now, is it's called the triangle. You're going to simply draw a triangle, just a triangle on a piece of paper. You can do that right now, or you can just write down triangle and do it later. We're not going to do the exercise now. And by the way, Emily has put for me in the chat room my email address. If you have questions later about my workshop or other stuff or the shows, we have UnCabaret Zooming and also additional contact information. You're gonna draw a triangle, and this is like a diagnostic tool. This is a tool that's gonna help you find who you are and where your comedy comes from. In each corner of that triangle is gonna be a piece of you. And this isn't all of you. How can you just put yourself into three things? You're so many things, you're Dymaxian. Of course you are. We're all huge, but all of our comedy and all of our stories generally come from a much more limited place. So the kinds of things that go in this corner are, they can be sociological, they can be geographical, they can be emotional, they can be, so anything from like Jewish, New Yorker, gay, recovery, overthinker, I'm an introvert, divorced, single mom. And each corner is also a nexus of many different kinds of things. So Jewish might relate to being an overthinker. It might relate to being an outsider. It might relate to being a New Yorker. It might relate to the way you eat. It might relate to an understanding of culture. there are a lot of different things that, so for any one person writing Jewish down, it would mean something different. You know, being a seeker might be the kind of something you would use. And you can take anybody, I don't know, I just was trying to think of an example, maybe Dave Chappelle, because I think he's on my mind because he did that very current piece. And, you know, for Dave Chappelle, I would say political and stoner and dad. But he might not say those three things. He might include, he might say black, and underneath black, it might be political might come there for him. And there are things that sort of, you know, because you're a stoner and political, then something, you know, everything doesn't exist. But what happens is if you start to identify those three things, and often, by the way, two will be super clear, and one will be very mysterious. And it might take a while to get, oh, I'm thinking of one of my students from last year, just started doing a podcast called Sad Jock. And she talked about her mental, you know, her various emotional breakdowns, fear of fainting and this and that, but she was also very athletic and how, so I was like, and at one day she was talking, I was like, oh my God, you're a sad jock. That's what you are. And it's those two things. And then you think of Eddie Pepitone, for instance, Bitter Buddha. Those two things are very different. And then there'll be another quality, maybe an unnamed quality that's part of it. So, you know, doing that work. So in each corner will be a lot of story elements. That will be where you look for your story. So that's a chunk. And then I want to talk about the story stuff itself. You know, the most compelling comedy is of course is story. I mean, that's what we care about. That's what we, besides hair. I once met Dennis Miller and at a Saturday Night Live after party, and I was just starting out. I was so starry eyed. And he said to me, well, I'll tell you the secret of comedy. I was like, oh my God, here it is. And he said, secret of comedy is hair and eyebrows. And he walked away. I was like, oh my God, that might be true. And it's not true, obviously. It's stories. It's stories. It's obviously stories. And in each of those corners of your triangle, you're going to be able to find stories. You're going to start, that's where you're going to start digging. And if you don't know what the triangle things are, you start looking at your stories. And from the stories, you sort of evolve what the triangle is. The triangle is a diagnostic tool. It's not in itself any result, and it will change over time. You might go from being a single mom to being a stepmother to eight to being, I don't know, you know, many different things. And also who you are, the way you are can change. But your stories, I think of this part as your own personal sutra. If you think of your stories as like a bowl of beads, that's like, okay, you can pick them up, they fall down. But the thing you're looking for is you're looking for your thread. You're looking for the thread that these stories are going to be able to be beaded on so that you actually have a necklace or a bracelet or mala, whatever, you know, your own personal sutra. The sutras are the through lines, they're the directives. And when you're in the hospital, when they sew up your wound, they suture your wound. So you think of stories. I heard a thing on the radio today. It was a doctor came out, just wrote a book, and she was talking about how they've gone from taking, you know, you would come in as a patient and you would tell the story and they would write your story down, and now they have to put it in electronically. And because they have to put it in electronically, and it's about finance, it's about how they're going to bill insurance, suddenly she's lost the thread to story and how the stories are part of the healing. That is how the healing happens. And that is essentially what you're doing. You're trying to find the suture for yourself and understand what your story is so that you'll understand what you're about, in a sense, you know, your core, your spine, that is what you're looking for. So you wanna look for that. Those are two of the biggest ideas. And, you know, when I work with people, we work on finding that thread, finding those corners, connecting those two things, but there are easier things. there are tricks, you know, the simplest tricks, like if you want to go, aren't there like little things I could just do? Yes, K sounds, like K sounds. That's the easiest thing. Make your sounds harder, but that's funnier. It's hard, more funny to have a dick joke than a penis joke. That's just why we have dick jokes and not penis jokes, because of the K. And the K, it's like it hits, and part of that hitting is where is comedy. That's, you have to not be afraid to punch. And courage is a big part of being funny. Thinking it might be funny, but you know, or knowing it's funny, but you've never heard anything like that, and actually doing it because it might not be funny, but you think it is. So courage, if I could give you that, I would be zooming from my mansion. Courage is, from a word that means from the heart. And those, if you think about the comedians you love, that is probably who you love, is comedians who are working from their heart with courage. You have to have the courage. I'm going to talk about courage and timing together. They do go together, courage and timing. When I started out, this is just to remind myself that this, I'm connecting this right now, courage and timing. When I started out in comedy, I had already done a lot of one-woman shows and toured the world, and I was very successful performance artist, whatever, you know, lay into that as you will. So I had spent a lot of time on stage. I was comfortable on stage. So I was working in this one sort of bridge and tunnel club, and the guy, the club owner, said to me one day, I got off stage, he said, I don't understand it. They're listening to you, but they're not laughing. That never happens. So, and he was just very baffled. And then a couple of gigs later, he said to me, I figured it out. It's your timing. That's why they're not laughing. They're listening, but you're not laughing because you're doing like jazz timing in a rock club. Like you have to do the comedy timing back. It's like 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. It's not 1-2, 1-2, 1-2. And that's it. And I was like, oh my God, thank you so much. That's amazing. So I was living in New York and I just thought this is the easiest fix. I'm just gonna go around New York going like 1-2, 1-2. I'll just like get that rhythm in my head and that'll fit and then that's it. But of course, nothing is that simple. And that wasn't the fix. But it was in a sense because it did teach me that there was comedy timing and I had to find my own. Really the greatest comedians all understand punching and they all understand their own voices, their own rhythm, their own. I mean, you know, I once said, and I would just say it and pretend that, but it's so like such a, like the rhythm of your voice is the wave that your inner truth rides in on. And that is just true because if you have your rhythm, I mean, it's one of the techniques of comedy that can really work, and especially can work on Zoom, is the rant. And the rant is all rhythm. I mean, and one way I learned about rhythm is when we were editing on cabaret audio stuff, I would be in the other room and I could just hear somebody. Couldn't hear what they were saying, but I could just hear the sound of their voice. You know, and Taylor Negron's rhythm or Dana Gould's rhythm or Patton Oswalt's rhythm. It was specific and different. I could hear the way they spoke. The way you learn that and the way you're able to accomplish that is annoyingly recording yourself and listening to yourself and understanding that, you know, you don't quite sound like yourself yet. Part of it is not being afraid to punch. And part of that is if you're, generally the people who find me, I assume you guys are mostly nice people. I don't attract like riffraff generally. So you're thinking punching, I don't know. Is that like hurty? I don't know. You wanna think about punching up really. The great comedy is about taking down power structure, taking down, those who are overinflated. And often that means ourselves. I mean, when I say those who are, in each of us is ego, and your ego self is part of what you're going to punch up at. And so basically self-deprecating comedy, which is a huge, huge pile of comedy. I mean, you won't find probably one comedian who's not at least a little self-deprecating, because that's the essential comedy instinct. So you're punching up at your own ego, punching up at power structures. Punching up is, you know, still punching though. So what happens, interestingly, is I don't really gender identify almost anything in comedy, but I will say that there's one thing, which is when I've noticed when people get nervous, male comedians and speakers tend to go flat, like super flat, like, what do you mean? Nothing's happening. I'm not having a feeling. Nothing can hurt me. This is really just what it is. Everything's okay. Don't worry about a thing. I'm just fine. And female speakers, comedians will go kind of high, and they get in this place that's not very comfortable at all to listen to, and you can easily catch yourself. Then that goes to dynamics, which is one of the biggest things that I think differentiates even great beginning comedians from more advanced. The thing that I, when people come in and they already have like great material and they have a good instinct and maybe they even have timing, there's still a dynamics which you can really use to get funnier. By dynamics, what do I mean? I mean, you know, are you willing to be a little bit soft sometimes and get really loud? I mean, and I think you could probably all think about the loud comedians. And it's funny because you think of the people who are very monotone. Somebody like Stephen Wright is super flat. You think Stephen Wright is super, but it's more dynamic than you imagine. There's a less of a modulation, but it's still very modulated. Dynamic, fast and slow, soft and quiet, staccato and legato. I mean, I think if you think about singing, that is, we have a question. How do you even start? Okay, that's a good question. I'll take that question. I'll answer that question. How to even start? Well, the answer to how to start is always the same. Whether you're in yoga, doing comedy, having a kid, start where you are. I mean, honestly, start where you are. So that's, I mean, not to be glib. So where your material is around you. Where your comedy is inside you. The first thing to do is make a decision. I want to be funnier. I want to get funnier. That's the very first thing. I own it. I want it. And that desire is something there's no replacement for. I mean, I remember for me, and I'm going to give you some other ideas, but when I was in New York, I remember walking around the streets. I'm in my 20s and I'm working, but I thought, you know, you've got a choice in life. You can here's the thing. I decided. You go along in life and then you get it and then you die. Like, that is what happens. And so either that's like insanely tragic or it's hilarious. And I thought, you know, you get a choice. You get a choice, and I'm going to decide that it's hilarious. But then that means that if I, and you know, from there, I was like, okay, well, if I want to be hilarious, what does that mean? And if I want to plug into that, and if I want to be someone who, I mean, I was funny for a performance artist, but I knew that I wasn't funny enough to be hilarious as a comedian. So I started working in comedy clubs, and that was hard. And, you know, and therein comes, you know, I don't understand, they're listening to you, but they're not laughing. But I was able to get funnier. I mean, you know, obviously at some pretty decent rate, at least funny enough. I got into clubs and blah, 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 blah. But so that's the first thing, is you make a decision. And then the second thing is you start to actually start analyzing. I would say analyze, like, look at who do you think is funny? Why do you think they're funny? Really start looking at great comedy and start opening your mind and your heart to wanting to be that. Okay, say you've done that. Then you start writing. I mean, it's a two-part process, the writing and the out loudness. And different people work at different, in, you know, for some people, a lot happens on the piece of paper. Like it really happens on the piece of paper, and they're methodical and they're rigorous and they write every day. I mean, Jerry Seinfeld famously was like, you know, don't miss one day. That's the difference between me and everyone else. He was like, I'm not going to miss one day of writing. I'm just going to put in my time. And, you know, it can happen that way. And, you know, what, you know, you can do things like write down the things from your life, write down the news, try to, you know, connect one from column A and one from column B, pick something. You know, I'm angry. Okay. So commit to wanting it, commit to a work process and figuring out your work process. Three, understand this. Pain plus time equals comedy. That's it. Pain plus time equals comedy. I didn't make it up. Don't say I took Beth Lapides' seminar, You But Funnier, and she said the most brilliant, oh my God. I didn't say it, but nobody actually knows who said it. I mean, it's been attributed to everybody from like Lenny Bruce, Harpo Marx, you know, Moms Mabel. I don't know, everybody. Like everybody might have said it. So sure, maybe I said it. But when you think that, pain plus time equals comedy, let me break it down for you. Pain, what is pain? Sure, it's physical pain, but it's also jealousy, worry, anger, frustration, resentment, sadness. Sadness is the hardest, by the way, if that's your pain. Look for the loss underneath it and, I don't know, I would say, you know, in Hollywood, you're better off telling people that you shoot up than you're sad. I mean, people are just like, you're sad. Oh my God, don't, please. Sadness is the least funny of the pains, but still it's possible. There's a lot of hilarious impressions of people doing the crying and so sadness. But then there's little pains. You know, you went to Starbucks and the bad name they gave you and being misunderstood. I mean, a lot of light comedy is the pain of being misunderstood. Obviously, all the relationship stuff, breakups and divorce. And that's a good question. Okay. So pain plus time equals comedy. Let me take these questions and we'll keep talking about pain plus time equals comedy. Let's see if any of these are easy questions. How do you self-monitor over refining, over editing your story, not making it too smooth, accessible, and boring? Are you bored working on it? Then you've over refined it. You know, does it have any nubbin to it? Generally with rewriting, I mean, it's really hard. Writing, I would say, for me, I want to be able to read it, be interested, and not have my eye snag on something. If you're going through that process of reading and something catches you and it feels wrong, my friend Michael Patrick King always says when he's directing, if something bothers him a little, in editing, it's going to bother him so much and there's going to be nothing he can do about it. So he's gotten a good instinct for like, fix that red dress that's bothering you now. Like, just actually fix it. Not making it too smooth, accessible, and boring. I mean, if you're not interested, then it's too smooth, accessible, and it's too smooth. I mean, it's boring. If it's boring, it's boring. Don't worry about being too accessible. That's something you can take off your list. Nothing is too accessible. If it's accessible, that's amazing. You don't have to worry about that. Don't worry about being hard to get. People are, I can't emphasize this enough, tired. People are tired. The more accessible you are, the better off it will be. But you don't want it to be so smooth that people can't get in. Don't worry about over-explaining. Write things you're actually interested in. Write things you want to read. I mean, it's a great feeling to pick up an old piece and go like, oh my God, did I really write this? This was so great. I can't believe I wrote that. And so you want to go for that. And you know, there's a certain amount that you can't do for yourself. I mean, you do need readers. So you want to figure out what people are safe you know, and it may not be your closest people. Your closest people may not be great readers, but you might be able to develop a buddy, a writing buddy, a friendship. You might find a teacher, or there's a lot of teachers. A writing group can be good if you like the people in it. And you want to be sure not to share your writing too soon. If you're working on something, there could be something just very sacred about it, but there's also a way of working things out. There's like where you tell the story, where you're working it out loud with people. You remember there were those two Truman Capote movies? I'm trying to remember what the second one was called, but there was one that was less popular, but better, so good. And there's a sequence of scenes where he's telling the story of Executioner's Song to a series of his, you know, high society ladies. And you can see him, it's such a great sequence. You see him figuring out the story as he's dancing with these ladies and dinnering and lunching with these ladies. And it's so lovely, that writing process. You know, don't tell if your mom is the person who's always told you that you're not good enough, don't tell her what you're writing. You know, don't be that person, you know, sharing your gold with the person who's going to melt it down and turn it into a picture of themselves. I don't know where I came up with that, but whatever. Don't tell the person who doesn't like your writing what you're writing. So if it's too smooth, so that's, you know, at a certain point, so what I'm saying is don't spill the gold too soon, but also don't hold on to it too long. You do need readers, and you need to go, it's a process, and you want to find friends that you trust. You want to find people who know what they're doing. You want to maybe pay for a reading. I just finished a script. I'm going to pay someone to read it because, you know, I've lost perspective on it, and I trust them. So there you go. What will workshop students be assigned to do each week? What if a student doesn't prepare on a given week? That's fine. Each week, my workshop really is a workshop. I don't give group assignments, but I do make sure that you know what you're going to work on during the week. Generally, and especially now, because there isn't stand-up to do, there is Zoom, so we're working on that. It's a really great mix of people who are working on stand-up, memoir, spoken word, some scripts, we had somebody working on a novel, and it's not always all funny stuff. I can help you be funny, but it's also a great place for just working on your creativity. And if you have nowhere to start, then we just start talking. I don't say just start talking. I mean, I've been able to lead people, and I have a technique for leading you to your stuff. We can start with your triangle. We can talk about your triangle. We can talk about the stories. I have questions I can ask, and we can use your time. Basically, I give a little ramp up inspirational thing at the beginning, and then each person gets 10 minutes of dedicated time. And we can use your time conversationally, or you can present for 5 minutes and I'll give you 5 minutes of notes. It's not a group technique. It's not a group technique. It's not a group critique. You're not going to get like 10 different opinions about your story and what you should do with it. That is not what's happening. And I'm very clear, you know, about who wants to be funnier at the beginning of the session. You tell me if you want to get funnier, I help you get funnier. You tell me if you want to be writing a memoir, I help you write a memoir, you know, but there's nothing we can't cover. I don't have anything I rule out. I'm trying to think if there's something I rule out, but there isn't. Let people know I'm about to put donation info into chat. Thank you, Emily. This is freely given, freely offered, and I hope you receive it with an open heart. And if you'd like to make a donation, I gladly accept them. And there's information in the Zoom chat. Thanks to Emily, who is, say hi. Emily can wave hi to you now. She's helps us with our uncab Zooms, and she's a Zoom whiz, and I love her. Is it important to write wanting to connect or not worrying? And will the audience want to connect worrying with if the audience, if, will the audience want to connect with you? I think is the question, if you don't want to connect with them. That's a great question. I love that question. I'm going to say both. I'm going to say everyone's different. For me, I don't understand wanting to write and put it in a drawer. I mean, okay, there's journaling. That's important writing. I'm not saying don't do that writing. And of course, there's nothing to read in my journal that, you know, is, I don't write well in my journals. I just try to keep track of what's happening so that I can reference it again. I might try to figure out what I'm feeling. I tend to overthink. So sometimes if I need to know what I'm feeling, I'll sit down and try to figure it out in a journal. I also use them to track just exactly what is happening or to slow my mind down. If it's a great, I mean, if you're here, I would think you might be an overthinker. You might think too much and you might have spinning brain. And one thing that's so great for spinning brain is to sit and take a pen and probably not a Sharpie, but a Sharpie really slows things down because you have to write really big. But sit and write down your thoughts. Literally try to just track your thoughts. That is a great tool for writers. If you're a writer, you're thinking too much. If you're thinking too much, write it down. You can't write as fast as you think. So, you know, after 10, 15, 20 minutes, you know, you can call a friend, but, you know, you can talk a lot faster than you can write. It doesn't always slow you down to actually talk. I discourage the morning pages. That's a little bit controversial, but I find that sitting and writing those three pages is a lot of the juice. I end up using a lot of, did not work for me. It ends up being maybe a little bit complaining. I do like, as a writing warm-up, I suggest a gratitude list. A gratitude list puts you very connected to where you are in your life and what's good about it. And then you can go ahead and write all the complaints in your actual writing, write everything that's bad, all the pain, you know, you're going to write, you're free now to write your pain because you've been grateful. So you're not whining anymore. So if we're going to go back, finish that question, are you writing to connect or are you writing for yourself? I mean, if you're not writing for yourself, there's nothing there. I mean, you have to ultimately, for me, I think it's hacky. If that's, to me, the definition of hacky is you're just kind of, you know, churning it out. I love when people are engaged by their own work and writing because it's something they want to read, they want to hear, they want to tell. They're, you know, you want to be like, you want to know what it is that you write out so you find out. You write it out so you find it out. That's ultimately the thing. If you know it all already, then you don't have to write it. You already know it. So why bother? If you think like, so I'm going around and I'm like looking for comedy. I'm always like, is that going to be funny? And I have like, I think I encourage you to think like you develop like antenna. Like I think of one of those stupid, like little, you know, sparkly balls and they're bouncing around and they're bouncing more. Something's funny. Something's funny. So you write down waffle place. And you go, okay, there was a story at the waffle place. Then you write the waffle place and now you sit down to write it and you like, then you like mine it. And then you like really just like try to find every beat that's funny about it. You write more because sometimes that's the tiniest thing. So you write it all out and you explore it all out and then you say it once and then you're like, while you're saying it, you're finding more about it. You know, often you will find it in telling it out loud and then you told it out loud, then you write down what you said and always write what you actually said. Don't fix it. Like, I think that refers to that first question. Once you start fixing it, you often take the comedy out. You had it, they laughed. And now you're gonna make it better, but a lot of times when you made it better, you made it worse. So just trust yourself, trust. And that is a big, how do you start? You start learning how to trust yourself. You think something's funny, you try it, you write it, you see if it happened, and you open your mind to the fact that it might be an experiment. You might not know. So there's a willingness to not know, which is always true, but comedy is the experience of being a fool. I mean, that is what comedy is. So I don't know. I mean, it's the ability to say, I don't know. I mean, so much modern comedy is so opinionated and it's like, I know, and my opinion is this. I find that to be the most boring of the comedies. So I think you want to do writing to connect, even if it's to connect to yourself. If you think of it like that, I'm connecting with myself and I'm my first audience. then you're always going to be connecting with some audience. How big that audience is, maybe it's just you. Maybe it's, you know, 100,000 people, a million people. You don't know. But if you've connected to yourself, then you've done the trick. And, you know, then it's just about numbers. It's not about what the action is. How do I start writing stories for others? This is, these are good questions. I love it. If we're trying to locate the funny or up the funny of a character in developing a screenplay, would this be a good place to do that? Yes, it would be. Do you give prompts, or are we just writing on our own, developing acts and bringing it in? I'm happy to give prompts. I don't give prompts that you, that the whole class has to do. I would give very personalized prompts based on what you were working. And I absolutely will give you that. I will make sure you know what you're, I never want anyone to leave a session feeling like, oh, I don't know what I'm working on this week. I want you to always leave going like, I'm so excited to work on this thing. So yes, yes for prompts. Definitely, definitely, definitely. If you're trying to locate the funny or up the funny of a character, there are certain things. I mean, are they clear? Are they exaggerated? Exaggeration, whether it's in a cat, in a story or in a character, is one really great tool for comedy. Tiny and enormous are both funnier than medium. Just regular. I mean, you know, just kind of a thing. You know, little tiny things, huge, loud things. I mean, it's the cartoony part of comedy, and it's the picture part of comedy, and that's one way. Talking about a character, we have definitely, you know, talking about a character is one way to understand that character and understand what they want, understand who they are, understand the essential part of them, understand what they're not. You know, sometimes it's limiting a character. Sometimes it's having another character be their foil so they're not so responsible for everything. That can be a way to make a character funnier. Also, a lot of times people end up writing all the characters sound like them. Like, oh, well, these are all good lines that the author, you know, that you would say yourself. And once you start trying to find the different voices of different characters, that can really help you understand who that character is. All sorts of things. Have you named your character and given your character things that are funny? You know, do they have a job that, you know, has funniness in it? Do they have a name that's funny? Do they understand what's funny about themselves? Are they actually funny? I mean, are you writing a comedy and everybody's supposed to be funny? Are you writing a dark thing and there's supposed to be one funny character? That might be enough. It doesn't all have to be funny. The structure of the class is, I think I said that. Didn't I say it? But I'll say it again. The structure of the class is, I will bring in some, you know, inspiration, generally something I'm working on might spur me, or something I try to watch a lot, and something that might be very current and is important. We might talk about that, but it also might be a general principle, pain plus time equals comedy. How do you find the pain? We might look at that. It's not a class. I don't do the exact same thing each four times. It's a workshop, and I like to work from the place that I'm inspired by, because that keeps it interesting for me and it keeps me alive and in it, and you get a better teacher that way. And then we go, and you know, and that also, then we do a check-in where everybody sort of says what they're working on and asks questions like, are they blocked? Do they have a plateau? Are you overwhelmed with choices? Do you not know where to start? Did you do a reading and it worked out great? Did you do a reading? You know, are you in process, what you're in process with and your questions about it? And then we go through again, and you have 5 minutes of presenting time or a little bit more. And I give you 5 minutes of notes or a little bit less. And then after 4 weeks, your life has changed. I also do have people who I've worked with for, you know, who I've worked with for some time. Not that I didn't change their life the first time, but it's an ongoing process. And sometimes people have stuck with it. And that's been amazing. A good example of that is Jamie Bridgers, who you see on Cabaret on Sundays, and Variety just did a piece about when she came to work with me. She had never been on stage. So that's a good thing. How do I start writing stories for others to perform? Well, also, how much money? The class is $200, and that's for four sessions, or $300, which is four sessions plus a 1-hour private with me. And that 1 hour private is optional. And that's because some people have a lot of things they want to share that are just, they want to lay out their whole one person show and they need a whole hour to do it. And then we can work in 10 minute chunks. Some people are like, I want to tell you that, you know, want to talk about their abusive relationship they were in, or something super private. They want to talk about their recovery, or they just want private time and they want a little more and they want to know me better than they do. And we can do the private before we start or after or in the middle. It's very flexible that way. And I think that answers. So how do I write? Start writing. I don't think you necessarily, there isn't necessarily a different process to start writing stories for others to perform than for yourself. When you say stories, I'm assuming, do you mean scripted things like in a play? I think this is from C. So scripted things, do you mean writing scripted things in a play or
that could be from someone who is only appearing on here as my iPad.
So okay.
Expand your question. Yeah. And I'll send it to Beth. Thank you.
Yes. While you're doing that, I can talk about the pain plus time equals comedy a little bit more, which is always, you know, important to come back to. So pain, it can be enormous pain. It can be the heartbreak. It can be the loss of a spouse, Patton Oswalt in his, not the current special, Jokes. But the one before that. Or it can be, I fell and I tripped and I was humiliated in front of the guy I had a crush on. And generally, pain plus time equals comedy. The bigger the pain, the more time it takes to digest. And that's where you, when you hear people say too soon, that's where it's coming from. Oh, that pain was too big, therefore we can't do it yet. Often that will be something like, you know, 9/11, it was, you know, too soon. But at UnCab, people were doing 9/11 material, I want to say the next week, but it might've been 2 weeks later, because we were telling stories from a very personal place. And it was about, you know, how you felt and what the gas mask situation was and, you know, owning your fear. And, you know, it wasn't jokes. So if you're not writing jokes, you can really start to, I think of it as metabolization of pain. And this is where laughter is the best medicine part comes in. And this is where it is a lifelong journey. And this is where it's a quest and a spiritual path. Because if you are committed to being the fool and to not knowing and to being the zero card on the tarot deck and standing at the precipice and not seeing that you are, then, you know, that's a creative process. That's a journey. I mean, if anyone could come up with words to replace journey and authentic, I think that we would be, you know, real and take a real trip, you know, be real and take a trip. That's what you're looking for. And as you're doing that, that's where the comedy is going to come from. So pain plus time, how much time depends on the pain and depends on your skill. You know, in the same way that, you know, two different people can eat the same food and one will metabolize it like that and one will, you know, need to exercise 400,000 hours to work it off. Comedy also, some people are slower to write comedy and you'll hear some amazing comedians talk about how much time it takes them, that they're slow writers. And some people are just super fast, but then they can't hold on to it. You know, there's some performers who work in flow, just constant flow, with little rocks here that they're gonna step on. And some comedians are incredibly precise, every word, every syllable. And neither of those ways are the right way. They're both incredibly joyful to watch. So, you know, committing to that process is a lifelong task. And, you know, you get better and better at it. The better you know yourself, the better you understand your story, the better you understand the medium. So there's also that. You know, people who were stand-ups learning, you know, we had to figure out, like, well, what does it mean to do UnCabaret on Zoom? That's a different medium. What does it mean to take who you are. I mean, Karen Kilgariff is a great example. She's so funny, and you know, we've loved her so much at UnCabaret. And then it was so great. I mean, when My Favorite Murder came on, and she just nailed it because it was so much about her point of view and her feel for that kind of storytelling. So sometimes it's about, you know, just experimenting around and finding the right medium. And, you know, you might try script writing and find it's not for you, but then move to memoir and it is. And it's about, and Carl Reiner, RIP Carl Reiner today. I mean, look at how many different media he worked in. And it's so much about being hyphenated now. I mean, this time right now is a time to focus on your writing, because this time right now is not a great time for performing. It just isn't. Although, you know, audio performing, I'm working on an audio project, and Zoom, that's all real, but, you know, stage, okay. So this is a good time to work on writing. Everyone's a hyphenate. I mean, I remember a couple of years ago, I was reading some, I try to stay away from celebrity profiles, but for some reason I saw Brad Pitt said, he was going to stop acting because there was no parts. And I just thought, oh my God, if there's no parts for Brad Pitt, there's no parts. So he was going to start directing and producing. And, you know, and he has done amazing work as a producer. And it doesn't mean, you know, your performing work, your hyphen, and Carl Reiner. So anyway, my point was, you know, Carl Reiner was such an amazing hyphenate writer, performer, producer, director in so many different media. And that's really, the goal is to know your point of view. You know, the goal is to be able to sit down and write an essay and screenplay and learn and be willing to learn. And know what you're good at. You know, I'm not the greatest structuralist, as you might imagine, based on the fact that this entire thing has been flow. But I've gotten better over the years. I don't love thinking structurally, but I can make myself do it. And sometimes I just roll up my sleeves and like, okay, we're gonna think structurally. And I just make myself do it. And other people, but I can write dialogue like crazy. And sometimes it's about finding the right partner for that. And sometimes it's about getting better. And sometimes it's about, you know, watching stuff and learning and analyzing. Famously, Judd Apatow was as a child, watching TV shows and writing them down and learning, you know, writing it out in order to learn. And that's a great thing. I mean, Beth P, who I think might be Beth Powers.
I was just wondering, I have a lot of stories to tell and so forth, but I'm not probably one to get up and perform them. Mm-hmm. But I have a lot of shorter stories to tell, and they're jokes, you know. And I wonder about sending them for other performers to go.
Oh, I see what you're saying. That's a hard market at this place. I mean, if you have something, you certainly can send it to, you know, somebody, and you can certainly, you know, even do a pre-reach out. It's hard to get through to the people that you know, probably. And some people, I mean, late night shows have writers. That's a real job that people have, is writing for late night. Those monologues are all written by people. I have heard stories of people being in clubs and suggesting, giving material away to people, saying, I wrote this thing, it's not right for me. And it is possible. I want to just say it's possible. I know one maybe inspiring story about that. Alan Zweibel, who you may know his name, as a young man was writing, and this used to be more true, comedians would have, you know, would buy material because it wasn't so cult of personality. People did write more jokes, but you might be able to discern the comedians who do use jokes still. Anyway, so Alan was writing for a lot of people. He had some stuff that he would have written that wasn't good for anybody, and that stuff had collected. So he thought, well, I may as well go do it myself. So he went to the improv, but it might have been I think it was the improv. Anyway, one of the clubs. And he was doing it, and he's sitting at the bar afterwards, and some guy comes up to him and says, you're really an awful stand-up comedian. And Alan said, I know, I did. And he said, he says he did know. He was like, yeah, no, I know, I am. And he said, but you're a good writer, really good writer. I said, well, thank you. And he said, well, I'm starting a show and I'm looking for writers and do you have a packet? And Alan was like, of course I have a packet. And he said, well, send it to me. And he went home and he made a packet, which he didn't have, obviously. And he sent him his thing. And it was Lorne Michaels. And it was the first season of Saturday Night Live. And he was hired. So, you know, that does speak to the process. That speaks to if you have material for other people and you think maybe, you know, maybe. I don't know people that, you know, my circle, I don't know anybody who isn't doing their own material. But that doesn't mean it doesn't exist. And there are definitely people who steal material, and those people might be very happy to buy material. So I say always, follow your heart on that. If you feel like you have stuff that is for other people, and the other thing is maybe they're characters. I mean, maybe these things, you start to write them. Anything you want to write, start writing it, you know, without knowing what exactly it is. I say, if you have it and you imagine, I don't know, can you imagine what comedian it is? Just if you want to say, you don't have to say. No. Okay. So say you think it's good material for me and you write it, and then you have to actually ask the person, is it okay if I send it to you before you send it, because they don't want to read it because they don't want to be, you know, I have been blah, blah, blah. Anyway, you start writing it. Now suddenly you have a book of these things, or suddenly it's a blog, or suddenly it's, you know, a fun, hilarious Instagram account, or suddenly you've made a fake character on Twitter that people are in love with. You know, one thing to do if they're really jokes is to start, open up a Twitter account and tweet them at the people, get the people to notice you on Twitter by being funny in response to their material. That is a way to get the attention of known people. If you really have that in you to be funny on Twitter, if you're really writing jokes, get on Twitter, get a funny little icon and start getting into conversations with people. That's actually real. Rob Delaney, you know, he famously broke out on Twitter. And, you know, you have to know your voice and your medium, and can you come up with that stuff? You know, some people can write memes like crazy and then, you know, make an Instagram account that explodes. And that might be a way. Wow, it's 6:58, and I am committed to keeping these to an hour because... timing is everything in comedy, and always leave the audience wanting more. Leave them wanting more, Beth. Don't keep just talking. So unless there's any, and I don't see any from Emily here. Next Tuesday, I'm going to do at this same time, over the course of teaching, I've developed a lot of creativity things that aren't specifically comedy. And we did start getting into some of those today. Anyway, I call it 8 Habits of Highly Creative People. And I'm going to answer your questions about, you know, just starting, what if I get stuck, how do I break through blocks, all that kind of stuff. And then on the 21st in this time slot, but from 5 to 7 instead of just at 6, we're going to do the Beth Lapides workshop. And there's only 9 spots. So if you'd like one, go ahead and get it. And I think I am going to, there are no further questions. I'm going to thank you so much for being here. Thank you guys. If you were on Facebook not on Zoom, then you were the first audience there. And I thank you for that too. And thank you for being part of UnCabaret and for my life. And be funny and laugh a lot. And namaste.